Welcome back. The Philippine Stock Exchange is set to launch its short selling program next week. This is a known way to make money on stocks with falling prices, where traders buy back shares they borrowed and sold. So how will short selling affect the local bourse? Here to discuss that and more is Ruel Refran, COO of the Philippine Stock Exchange. Ruel, first time here in the studio. I'm very happy you came here, even though it's a holiday.
Oh, my pleasure, Salve. Always for Business Outlook.
Right. Okay, so now we're talking about short selling. I know that this has been moved again and again, and it's been much awaited. It's very clear that on the institutional side, it's something that the market anticipated and is really welcomed by the market so that they can make money both ways. It's not just a one-way street all the time.
Right.
But can you tell me more about the business model? The trading volumes this year have been very thin. Would this be able to change that? What are the numbers?
No. First of all, short selling, I would say it's a long time coming, right? But on the back end of the short selling program, there was a precursor to that, and we call that the securities borrowing and lending.
Mm-hmm.
And that's important at this point to highlight, because under our regulations, as approved by the Securities and Exchange Commission, short selling cannot be a naked short,
mm-hmm.
in the sense that you do not have a contract for borrowing, which means that's the security that you will deliver because you're selling short.
Right.
Okay. So in essence, the business model is, it might be an institutional investor, or for that matter, a retail investor, who feels that a particular equity security is overvalued one way or the other.
Mm-hmm.
And so he or she expresses his or her conviction by selling short that security, which unfortunately does not have a position on. He's not long.
Right.
He's short.
So he will have to borrow that stock from a broker.
Correct.
Yes.
There are parameters in place, because the last thing we want is for defaults to happen.
Mm-hmm.
Because if you are selling something and you have nothing by way of delivery securities, then 2 days later, remember, Salvi, we're already on shortened settlement cycle,
yeah.
just 2 days.
Yes.
Before
yes.
it was 3 days.
Yes.
2 days later, you have nothing to deliver.
Yeah.
Therefore, that is the important highlight when you look at short selling.
Mm-hmm. That the SBL has been there for quite, when, since when?
Oh, the regulations for SBL, Salvi, started in 2006, 17
right.
years ago.
Wow.
And then the Bureau of Internal Revenue came up with regulations back in 2008, or, you know, 15 years ago. So the business model is that there's a lender and there's a borrower.
Usually that's the broker and then the investor, right?
So, correct. So investors cannot do what's called direct lending.
Uh-huh.
They have to go to a broker.
Right.
And therefore, who will consume the product? It will be, for different reasons, it could be, I am a short seller, and therefore I will have to borrow from a willing lender
mm-hmm.
those securities.
Mm-hmm.
Now, why would the lenders let go of securities? Maybe it's idle securities, maybe they're ultra-long-term investors,
mm-hmm.
and they are looking for that extra spread, you know,
right.
the lender's fee. That's
right.
the rent, because you're
uh-huh.
renting those securities, but the obligation is that on a particular date, you're supposed to return the securities.
Right.
Plus whatever dividends may have been earned, and then you have to what's called manufacture that.
Mm-hmm.
You have to manufacture the dividends, in exchange for which you get a potential that hopefully, if you're correct, the prices do go down, then you have that your profit, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I say, If the price goes down,
because you lose money if the price actually goes up.
That's very correct.
Mm-hmm.
If the price actually goes up,
mm-hmm.
and you don't just lose money, but there's unlimited potential losses, because
yeah.
the price can go all the way up over time. No, any given day, we have what's called a static threshold.
Mm-hmm.
It can only go up 50% from the last closing, or 30% down from
we'll
the last
closing. We'll talk more about that later, because I think that's one of the controls that you have, so that we don't have the fears that people are saying that it can go, you know, people can use short selling to game the market or something
Correct.
Like that. But let's go first back into SBL. Are there other things, other market products that use SBL, not
oh,
just
very
short,
good question.
Yeah.
So SBL, that's a short for securities borrowing and lending,
mm-hmm.
is basically a risk management measure.
Right.
For example, there are fat finger errors. No, you know, in the haze
oh.
of things, you key in three zeros,
yeah.
which is probably one or two more than what you intended to. So that's
mm-hmm.
a fat finger error. The problem is you don't have exactly that number, which is overstated
mm-hmm.
by way of securities that you would deliver 2 days later.
Right.
Having an SBL in place, and how do you know there's an SBL in place? There's what we call the mother contract. It's called the Master Securities Lending Agreement,
mm-hmm.
MSLA.
Mm-hmm.
And that is a required core agreement. It's basically a loan.
Uh-huh.
Basically a loan. It specifies loan how agreement. Much is yeah. on loan by way of securities, what's the expected lending fee, mm-hmm. what's the rebate. Because when you give collateral, normally yeah. it's cash. Mm-hmm. That has to be invested, right? Mm-hmm. So it's not idle.
Right.
Because normally the borrowing could be as short as a couple of days, couple of weeks, couple of months, or as long as up to 2 years. That's mm-hmm. what's allowed pursuant to the framework.
So every time there's a transaction, you have the master...
Securities Lending Agreement,
or
MSLA.
Master Loan Agreement.
Yes, it's a master loan agreement, yeah. essentially.
All right. So when you started to talk about... I mean, I know that there's been a lot of discussion on short selling, a lot of delays. Did you expect that this would somehow bring more volume into the market?
Yes. So normally... there is that cycle, no? When you have the optimists and you have the pessimists, right?
Right?
In any market.
Right,
the
now,
optimists
a lot of
are
pessimists,
long.
Right?
Right, there's a lot
yeah.
of potential pessimists. Uh-huh. They sell uh-huh. it short. Maybe they just sell it, mm-hmm. right? First, I would say that it is a cycle. So when there are people who are selling short, there are people who disagree with that. That's mm-hmm. why you have a market. There are contrary opinions, right?
Yes.
So those who disagree would probably buy mm-hmm. because they know that over time this will increase. Mm-hmm. Those who probably say, no, I think I'm bearish that security, it's gonna go down, they'll probably sell it short, mm-hmm. right? So what happens, you have a more vibrant market because really, if you see a lot of short selling pressure on a given stock, at a certain point in time, there will be good news about the company. There might be, you know, the issuer may have derivatives, maybe it's a certain call options that it says, why do we have that exercise?
Yeah.
So there's a natural price increase, right? Because there's now buying pressure, right? So you see that adds to, okay, essentially it's a hedging mechanism. People who feel that they don't want to unwind their long positions, but they also see that maybe at a certain point, even if they're not there, they can do short.
Mm-hmm.
So it's hedging also their views about the market, number
right.
one. Number two, yes, because short selling has, I would say, the value, it enriches the informational content of stock prices.
Mm.
And I cannot overemphasize that because, as I said, if it's all the optimists weighing in on a stock, probably would be overvalued.
Yeah.
There has to be that, you know, that balancing factor. And that's probably where you have to have parameters in place
mm-hmm.
because indeed there are risks for those who engage excessively in short selling. Because you really don't know. There might be what's called a short squeeze. All you know, even before you have access already to close your short position, the lender is already saying, return the securities.
Mm-hmm.
There's a lot of pressure. I need to do this and that. And so that's a problem you have, right?
Mm-hmm.
In case you cannot return it, then what happens? Your collateral is at risk,
right?
Because that's going to be the recourse of the lender. It's going to say, okay, you don't have, just like any loan, right?
Yeah.
If you can pay back the principal,
yeah.
Well, let me take a look at your mortgage. Let me take a look at what I can foreclose
right.
and sell that off to essentially satisfy whatever you owe me, right?
Yeah.
So that's the same principle. Because short selling paired with SBL, essentially there is an equities loan transaction on the back end of a trading strategy. We are looking to profit from movements in the market price. Hopefully, it does
now it
go in your favor.
Movements that before it used to be just movements going up. Now
correct.
You have movements going down, and you can make money from that as well. And I think that's one of the things that international investors are looking at before they actually think about putting money in Philippine equities, because they might be EPIT. It's what we call EPIT in the local language, right?
Very correct. You know, Salve, just to add to that, if you don't mind. I've been in touch with some big foreign institutions, and they have already the MSLAs in place in many markets. This
are
is
we one of
new.
The last ones in the world?
We're probably a latecomer, but what we did was we benchmarked the regulations.
Mm-hmm.
I would say we're best in class because we picked the effective risk parameters and incorporated it in our rules.
Mm-hmm.
For example, now we incorporated the short interest ratio. 10% is the maximum, right?
Mm-hmm.
And to us, that's a proxy also of the view of the market. No? I mean, of course, it's not 100% an equivalent to hearing from the market. But, you know, when there's a lot of short sellers, you're probably looking at the market sentiment that, you know, maybe earnings may be hit and they
uh-huh.
might have a negative view of the company.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe there's potential fraud, hopefully
right.
not.
Okay.
And they feel
so
it's better to
stock?
Exit now
uh-huh.
and then, you know, later on profit from it.
Mm-hmm.
So I was saying, when you look at short selling, it's a product that has to be there. Investors,
mm-hmm.
you're correct, would rather be in a market where there's that hedging tool, right, rather than be in a market where there's long-only position. You cannot hedge.
No way for them to get out when the market's falling down, right?
Correct.
And that's a
correct.
Very big problem. Now you don't have the money in the first place because people are scared they might get ipit. That's my point. But is this something that our retail investors are ready for?
Okay. So there's a little bit of complexity to it, right? Because you might wonder, this is counterintuitive. Normally, you buy long. You buy a stock and, you know, in the capital markets over the long term, hopefully there's capital appreciation, right? But this one is different. So we always say it's best to consult your brokers or trading participants if you're a retail investor, because they may have requirements before they will open this up for the retail, right? That might be a safeguard that they would institute. For the institutions, however, it's something that, you know, it's data-driven. They may have a theoretical price. Why are they coming to a conclusion that's overvalued? They have their own due diligence. They have their own data analytics. And therefore, they probably are more, heavily data-driven. And they have that conviction, a firmer conviction. No? But that's not to say that we should close this to retail. We feel it's a tool that in the evolution of our market would necessarily also have to be understood properly by the retail investors. But I guess from the get-go, maybe more of the institutionals would pick it up and see that, you know, they want to take advantage also, both from the potential lenders also, because when you short sell, you're borrowing eventually.
Yeah.
Potential lenders will also see, like, the big social pension funds probably earn some spread over idle assets that, you know, otherwise they would have just been not income producing.
Right. Now, when we talk about short selling, people always think about, you know, the GameStops of the world, where the vote of no confidence on a particular stock just to sort of put pressure on it if they don't like the company. Could that happen in the Philippines? Okay. I think people are asking that also.
Good question. That was foremost in our minds, right? We saw what happened in GameStop. It's like the revolt of the masses.
Yeah.
They saw that there were short sellers, institutional. They wanted to teach them a lesson. Let's buy it so that prices go up and then they have mark-to-market losses.
Yeah.
In the Philippines, we have parameters in place. Number one, not all securities can be sold short. Why is that? Because we have clearly defined parameters. Number one, has to be a constituent company of the main index, PSEI.
Yeah, so it's the PSEI, the mid-cap.
The mid-cap and the dividend yield.
And the dividend.
And exchange-traded fund, which currently we have one.
Only
okay.
one. Yeah.
Number two, when you do a short, it has to be at what's called an uptick price, which simply means it's one increment or one tick size higher than the last rated price. No? In short, if there's downward pressure, at least you have that natural parameter. No? It's one tick size higher compared to the last traded price. And I mentioned earlier, we have what's called the short interest ratio. Any given time.
I wanted to ask more about that.
Sure.
Yeah.
So SIR, as we call it, sir, short interest ratio.
Sir.
We're just making sure that right now the level we pegged it at is 10% of the outstanding equity securities of that listed company.
Okay,
right?
So beyond the 10%.
Beyond that, we will disallow short selling.
Okay, there's
in short,
a cap.
It will be restricted all the way up to 10%. Okay,
right.
So you have that. And then finally, I think the parameters of both making sure that the covering transaction, because, you know, we don't want naked short, that's disallowed, that's subject to sanctions. But if it's a covered short, you have the SBL arrangement. And that also has its own parameters. There's collateral required. Okay, if it's cash, minimum is 102% of the outstanding shares on borrow or on lending, right? Market goes up 50 up, 30 down, then probably naturally if you engage, we also have a lending agent as a business model. Maybe they'll ask for 150% by way of collateral. So that's pretty much the maximum amount that you potentially could lose if you default.
All right.
Because that's the collateral you gave, right? And essentially, I think it's more making sure that when you do a short, there are proper reports that are given.
Right.
Because there's tax advantages also on the borrowing components.
Oh.
Yes. That incentivizes SBL, not just for risk management, for the fat finger and all, but also for short selling.
Right.
Because otherwise, when you do the borrowing component and you get slapped with the STT, that's kind of prohibitive.
Right.
So that's actually a loan.
Uh-huh.
But if you comply with all the regulations, this is what we keep telling everyone, is that your assessment risk is pretty much zero, because the BIR itself has allowed SBL for purpose of short selling, SBL for purposes of what's called fails management. Mm. And so when you return the securities also, right, it's a loan, it should also not attract a stock transaction tax. So that facility, it's an ecosystem. It's, I believe it's a self-reinforcing mechanism.
Net-net so benefit.
The net benefit hopefully to everyone, to the capital market, is net positive.
Fantastic. And I hope that will improve the volumes of the market as well.
I hope so.
Thank you, Ruel. Not enough time. We haven't talked about your marathons this year. Maybe when you come back.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Anytime.